Okay, so maybe we can start already. Because I'm going to ask for collaboration and I want to practice a lot. I always say that I'm not going to talk too much, but at the end I do. I talk quite a lot. So my goal for today is that we start practicing in about 15 minutes, all the techniques, 20 minutes, let's say. There are about 10 techniques, something like that, that I would like to see. They are very short techniques. And I'm going to explain to you how they work. One of the things that is helping me a lot with my clients is to know how hypnosis works in the brain and how the techniques that we are using can help our clients. This is something that I learned at the hypnosis school, and it's something that I even more interested now when there are new research about neuroscience, neuroplasticity, and more we can see the effectiveness and how hypnosis is working in the brains of the people. This makes me feel more confident when I work with clients to know that there is science behind it. Like, okay, what I'm doing, even if it might look a little bit like fluffy for some people, I know that there is some reasoning behind, there is some science, so it makes me speak with confidence when I'm in front of my clients. Because sometimes, as you know, when we are at this hypnosis school, we learn things, but we don't really know what is the science behind. We don't really know why we are using those techniques and how those techniques are affecting our brain or changing our brain. So my goal for today is to speak maybe 5-10 minutes about neuroplasticity. There is one man that is called Jeffrey Schwartz. I don't know if that's the right pronunciation. And I would recommend you to see his work. And basically, hello.
Yeah.
Hypnosis.
Yeah, John is my name.
So hi, John.
I saw the sneeze up very late. I'll sit down here.
Sit down, take a seat and feel comfortable. You're welcome. What do you need? What do you need? A pen? Yo soy español. Sí, sí tengo.
Sorry. I have one of the cards, but you could. I'll go and get it.
If you've got a long Ivan, I've got a
pillow. I let you use mine. That's a good pen.
We'll share it.
No, that's
share
not.
It, yeah.
Okay. So what's your name again?
John.
John. You have okay, we are more or less, we are cousins. We are cousins. Okay, now we are just doing the introduction. You are very welcome. I haven't seen you before, but probably I'm going to see you many times from now on.
I'm not a therapist or anything, so I'm just a joke soul.
Okay.
So I'm not a professional therapist, just to get the record anyway.
Okay, and so now that you are here, why are you interested in this meetup?
I have somebody in my family that suffers from anxiety.
Uh-huh.
And I thought maybe I should learn a bit more about it.
That's a fantastic idea.
I was interested in learning maybe about hypnotizing. Do you learn how to hypnotize people?
Okay, you can do it. Maybe you get something how to hypnotize people from this meetup. Hi, Anne, okay. How are you? But probably, hello, come in. Don't be shy, come in, take a seat. It's all right, we are just starting. How are you, Anne?
I'm very well, thank you. I brought you one
here. Yeah, very well. Hi, how are you? Take a seat, nice to meet you. I'm Ivan.
Nice
to meet you. Hi, Ivan.
I'm so sorry about the traffic call.
That's okay. Traffic is this is happening. So welcome everyone. I'm just doing the introduction right now. And I can see new faces, new friends. You are all very welcome. And today we're going to speak about anxiety and anti-anxiety tools that we can use to help our clients, or as in your case, John, you might use to help someone in your family, a member of your family. My name is Ivan, and today I'm going to show you some techniques that I use in my practice. I'm a hypnotherapist myself, and I use most time these techniques. These techniques, I might incorporate them into my hypnosis session, but probably after I'm going to show you how you can include these techniques into a hypnosis session. But you can use them at any time just to teach to your clients in a practical way. Look, whenever this is happening, you are feeling like this, just do this. Whenever you have this feeling, your heart is beating fast, or you notice that your hands are sweaty, just do this. Because I was speaking 3 minutes ago about neuroplasticity, And years ago, there weren't studies and there wasn't a research about how we can change our brain. Our brain is plastic, which means that we can modify our brain. And the way to modify our brains is by changing our thoughts. Before, we used to identify brain and thoughts as just one thing. Now more and more, we're identifying thoughts and brain. They are two completely different entities. However, one is affecting the other. So it's important to know how our brain works so we can use these techniques with a confidence. As you know, our brain is full of neurons, and I'm going to explain to you how our neurons are firing together and how they are wiring together.
This is amazing. I'm reading the brain that changes itself at the moment.
It's amazing, all the research, and there is more and more research. This guy is doing a lot of research in relation to neuroplasticity, and usually we create habits. Those are called habituated patterns, those habits. When we create those habits, those neurons fire together and they work together. The good news is that we can break that loop, we can break that pattern. And that's what we are going to see today, which techniques we can use to break that anxiety loop or any other unwanted habit that you would like to break, or unwanted behavior, because it's more simple than we might think or people might think. What we are going to do during these first maybe 10-15 minutes, I'm going to explain to you a little bit about this theory about neuroplasticity, and after we're going to start practicing the techniques. I want you to practice all the techniques, just take down notes if you want, and even if you just take with you one or two techniques, I will be very happy, and you start practicing. Because they are more or less doing the same job, but for some people might prefer ones instead of the others. I have like 10-12 techniques that I know and I use, not all of them every day, but most of them I might use, depending on the person. So imagine that that's a neuron. How the neurons wire together, or they fire together. We have an idea, we have a thought, and automatically we have a feeling too. This is a neuron with all the dendrites here. Imagine the idea, one idea, a simple idea about money. Probably people might think, oh, money. Oof, it's difficult to get money or to earn money. And after there's another neuron that say, yes. I know some people that make money, but it's not easy. So what happens if we have this belief? These neurons are going to fire together because we have that belief and we are hearing always to make money is difficult, to make money is difficult. Yes, I know some people that are making money, but it's not easy. Okay, so there is here another neuron. Three neurons that are firing together, and they wire together to the brain. They stick to the brain. And any time and every time that we had that thought that money is difficult, and even though I know some people that make money, it's not easy to make money, we are strengthening this synapse. This is a synapse. We have the dendrites, the neuron, the nucleus.
What's that word? Can you say that word?
Synapse. And we are reinforcing that all the time that we are having the same thought. That's happening with any behavior that we are having or doing, or with any automatic behavior. Usually when we talk about automatic behavior, we are talking about the subconscious part of the mind. Is where usually all those automatic behaviors are stored. And every day we have like 10, 15, 20, even 100 different automatic behaviors. Even when you wake up in the morning, I would like you can test it tomorrow. Probably you do always the same. You don't think. You get up, you go to the toilet, you prepare the coffee like a zombie. You just do everything. You just put your clothes. You don't even have to think, okay, how do I put my legs into the trouser? You don't think about that. Those are automatic behaviors. However, you know that you might, so there is, imagine that there is, oh, my alarm went off, I wake up, I feel that I have to go to the toilet, I'm going to get my coffee. So there is a connection between all these neurons. And do you believe that you can break these dendrites, this connection, this synapse? Do you believe that it can be done?
Will you tell us the techniques in a few minutes?
I'm going to tell you the techniques. However, in that simple example, when you wake up in the morning and you just do all the time, every day, the same thing, it's as simple as, instead of preparing the coffee, the first thing, become aware. Okay, I'm getting up in the morning. I know that every day I go to prepare my a cup of tea. So this time I'm going to do something different. I'm going to get dressed first. What is happening when you start doing that? That another neuron here with the dendrites start to create a small connection, very thin connection. Oh, so this morning this person is getting up and is not doing the same that every day. So the day after probably is going to be very, very difficult for you. So tomorrow morning, when you wake up in the morning and you do something different that you have always done, it's going to be difficult, but you do it again the day after and the day after, and you start strengthening this connection between this neuron and this other neuron here.
You describe it in the book as going down a snowy hill and a toboggan. You know, like the first time it's hard, you go down and you make your channel, and the next day you tend to go down the same channel, and that reinforces it. And every time then it gets harder and harder to go a different channel because you're strengthening all the time.
Yeah.
That's a really good image to have.
Yeah, exactly. That's a fantastic example.
Those are neuropathways.
Yeah, those are neuropathways. These are neuropathways. That's what we are building all the time, neuropathways. When we are repeating over and over the same thing all the time. For that reason, when we want to break a pattern, we have to repeat over and over something different. There is a study that of this man. He studied a number of people with OCD, Obsessive Compulsive Disorder. And he just scanned the brain of these people when they felt that compulsion to do something. Some people might wash their hands, some other people might wash their car, some other people might clean their house compulsively. So when they had that feeling of maybe washing their hands, this man scanned their brain. And they saw that there was a part of the brain that it was very activated. So he thought, okay, so what about if when they had that compulsion, instead of washing their hands, I tell them to do something different, even if it's difficult for them, but they can do it. Only that it's an automatic behavior. I have a feeling that my hands are dirty. I feel a little bit anxious because my hands are dirty. I had to wash my hands. Okay, first of all, anytime and every time that you might have that feeling, you have that feeling every day. So you know when you recognize that feeling. Instead of washing your hands, go to the garden. For some people, some other people told them, instead of washing your hands, prepare a cup of tea, a cup of coffee. Do something completely different.
What, sorry, what, when you say that, why is the person so scared that I have to wash my hands? Would it, do you think it would still work if you said, okay, spray your hand with a spray instead, do something, it's still different with that, but you're making it easier for the person.
Yes, that's something different.
You are, they're still dealing with their need, but they're dealing with it in a different way.
He said that rather than doing some exposure, like rather exposing to people who are fixated on, you know, things being dirty, that they just try and stop and say, yes, I have a problem now, but the problem isn't that my hands are dirty. The problem is that I have this compulsion, this obsession, so to try and change them into something positive and something completely away from, rather than reinforcing the idea that the hands are dirty.
Yes, in your particular case, probably wouldn't work.
It's a different thing, but what you were saying about actually doing something different, I'm just wondering, would it be necessary if the person can't do something completely different to at least do something that still deals with their problem, but being different, at least, to get through the habit connection?
From my point of view,
yes.
If you start doing something that is different than what you are doing, if it's related to your hands, it might be okay because you are breaking the pattern.
Yeah.
But if you are start getting into the habit of just putting the spray,
well, yeah.
If it's something irrational, that doesn't really make sense.
I'm just thinking of the person who can't do it.
No, I have to find a person
difficult.
Yes. Oh, you like that story?
Yes, would it be a help to sort of maybe find a different way to clean your hands every day, a different way because you're at least breaking the habit connection, neuron, synapse connection, even if you're still...
For instance, in her case, that wouldn't work with her because that's for her more or less the same, isn't it? It's like you will need to do something completely different that is not related to the hand.
This is getting much better results than CBT. They seem to be saying.
You mean the studies of this man?
Yeah.
Do you know about this man?
I think it's him that he's written about in the book that I'm reading at the moment.
Okay.
I've forgotten the name of the guy, the brain that changes itself. One of the chapters is about neuroplasticity and OCD, and I think it must be Jeffrey Schwartz.
Yeah, probably. It's becoming very popular because there is the brain scan that is saying, okay, if this is the brain...
I can't remember the name of the writer, sorry, but it's a great book.
That's no problem.
It's called The Brain That Changes Itself.
There is one book that is called The Mind, Mind in the Brain, The Mind in the Brain, one of his books. Yeah.
For stroke victims and for OCD and for all sorts of...
Yeah, it's fantastic. It's amazing
that
we can do that with our brain.
Yeah.
And before, we didn't know that, at least, but now we know that.
It was kind of a leap of faith before with hypnosis.
Yeah.
Now we're starting to really get proof that it's indisputable.
And for that reason, when we are giving our clients CDs to listen to them over and over, repeating over and over, what we want is just they break the unwanted behavior by doing that. Because what this man saw in the brain scanner is when they first saw the brain scanner with the compulsive feeling situation, this part of the brain, it was activated. After between 4 and 6 weeks, he did the same brain scanner for the same people, but this time after doing all what he had told them to do. And he saw that the brain scanner was showing that there were other parts of the brain that they were activated, and this one was much less activated. So it was much, much weaker, the part of the brain, that it was before. So the scanners are showing that we can break those habits. And that happens with anxiety. Probably some of you know how the anxiety loop works. In this case, it's not always like that. A person might have a feeling, a physical feeling, maybe in their hands, in their heart. Automatically, they believe that something might happen to them, and they are having that anxiety feeling. It's like, oh, I know this. Something is happening to me. And after feeling the physical sensation, thinking that anxiety, and after the anxiety comes the panic attacks, because it's like the heart starts beating faster and faster. People might start believing that they are dying from a heart attack. They can't breathe because they are creating the movie, the story that the situation is getting worse and worse and worse.
And if it is, then if the situation is actually getting worse, if anybody deal with it, somebody buries you down in a coffin, so it is getting worse. Do you know what I mean? So,
what is your question?
I don't sound like a pessimist, but I've been in a couple of tight corners myself, and my brain was racing, and I had to deal with it very quickly.
And what is the reason that you believe that gets worse? Because you know that there is nothing wrong with you. You are okay.
There is something wrong.
Well, I just think that one or two situations where I would have to deal with very quickly. So, what I'm saying is you have to decide between what's actually real and what's not real.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay. And in many cases, what happens is that an anxiety attack, you don't risk your life. Your life is not in risk. At the moment, nobody has died from an anxiety attack. So you might feel, you might have those feelings as if you were dying, but nobody never ever has died from a panic attack. Nobody ever ever has died from an anxiety feeling.
Never given anyone a heart attack who has a weak heart anyway, who's very anxious.
Yeah.
Could happen.
Well, at the moment, there are no recordings that someone having a panic attack has had a heart attack and has died from that. So it means that we are creating that something very bad is happening to us. The anxiety usually comes from an anticipation. We're anticipating consciously or subconsciously. You might not believe because what this is happening, when this happened once, you're wiring all that. Happened twice. And maybe at the beginning there was a reason. Maybe there was a death of a family member, there was a traumatic experience, traumatic situation. So what happened with those neurons are creating that loop. And there is a moment that you are just relaxed at home. Now you tell us your experience, and I will be delighted if you want to share.
Well, it's particularly bad, so it was. But it was a family member that I had to stop close from taking her life. So that was really tough.
Yeah. I haven't said that in many cases anxiety is very related to depression. I'm not saying that your family member is suffering from depression. Anxiety, depression, and anger in many cases are very related. I'm just focusing on anxiety, but I could talk about depression too. I don't know exactly the particular case of your family member.
But it was somebody pretty close. I just happened to be there at the time, so it was traumatic.
Yes. Because probably in that case it's not just anxiety. Was that person diagnosed?
That person had been, something bad happened to them. And a traumatic experience, and they hid it for years and then it came out. And we didn't know about it, but we had an idea something bad had happened. Because of that, when it manifested itself, I happened to be there at the time, so.
Hi, how are you?
It's something you don't forget.
It's something that, I don't know if that family member was diagnosed with depression too. Was he diagnosed with?
No, she wasn't.
It was just anxiety?
Anxiety, but it was buried, this problem, for years. We knew something had happened, but then we found out exactly what happened.
Okay, and how is he now?
It's long term, what she suffered long from this, because of this.
Okay, so hopefully you can get some good tips.
Well, that's...
And you can help your family member. I'm sure that you can get something. Because if that family member had a traumatic experience, probably she built this neural pathway. From the traumatic experience, she felt anxious, she got a panic attack. Maybe not at that moment. At that moment, maybe it was 1 month after. And again, after the panic attack, she has the feeling that another is going to come. She might be feeling that he's dying. She might be feeling like that for 1 hour, 30 minutes, one day. And after that feeling, she comes to normal, but it's not completely normal. Because she might start thinking, okay, I have a fear that this might happen to me again. So you are strengthening, again, the loop. And that's what usually happens with anxiety. It's like, you are into that loop, okay. I know that something happened to me in the past, and I might be quiet, just watching TV, and this loop is activated. And you don't have to be nervous or stressed, because it's in your subconscious mind. It might be related to that traumatic event, and usually, after that traumatic event, this neural pathway is created. But the good news is that we can break that pattern. In the case of that family member, we could find the root cause of the problem. That would be something different to do. That would be through regression in relation to hypnosis. But you can help the person to feel much better. Even if you don't heal the root cause of the problem, you might help the person to start building new neural pathways, more positive pathways. And how are we going to do that? With these techniques that we are going to show you. Because what we want is just to break this pattern here. We want to break that. We want that as soon as the person, anyone, is having an anxiety feeling, just a physical feeling, it might be the hands, a sensation, an uneasy feeling, an uneasy sensation, as soon as the person is feeling like that, is when we have to break the pattern there. And here's when we are going to use the techniques that we are going to see. We don't have to wait the person to start feeling worse and feeling more anxious, because after the anxiety, the panic attack might come. And after the panic attack, the fear that another panic attack might come. And we start again. When you are having that fear of another panic attack, you start noticing that your heartbeat is going to beat fast. So there is a bad loop here that is built in your brain that we can break, and we need to break. Does it make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense, but I think the situation has gone so far at this stage. She's on medication, so it's a difficult one.
Of course.
Now, I'm not a doctor, I'm just I'm related to her, but I was interested just to find out, because I saw this at 5 minutes before I came over. I live in Greystones, and I said I'd have to come over for this.
You're very good, and I'm sure that your family will be delighted that you are here investing your time.
Yeah.
That tells a lot about you, and I'm sure that your family will know that you are here.
Well, I'll tell them afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. I think even her going into more understanding it more.
Yeah, well, that's what
I think a lot of people don't understand it. A lot of people don't understand it, so I would say it's helpful already.
Yes. Yeah.
Everyone is completely different too, but you can help just by being here and understanding a little bit better. That might help your family member. And you can start using some of the techniques, because what happened with your family, can I know the name of
the? No, I'm sorry.
Okay, so can I call her your family Carmel, member?
Carmel.
Carmel, okay.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Is that she's feeling like that all the time. So she's building those neural pathways in her mind.
Yeah.
And that's what we call an habituated pattern. And okay, you have two options. First, you can take tablets, Xanax, you can start taking all the psychotropics that the psychiatrist is going to give you, that is going to numb your body. I'm not saying that they are not helpful, because they are helpful in many cases. And my approach is supportive of probably psychotropics combined with other mind and body techniques that we can use. Because what happened with psychotropics medicines is that usually they numb the feelings. You don't know, for a while you might feel good, but you don't know what is happening inside of your mind. And the truth is that there is an issue that should be dealt with. And maybe that person, by taking psychotropics, is just hiding behind a wall. And that's what happened in many cases with medicines. For that reason, that approach of mind-body connection with medicine until the person is able just to deal by herself, I think that is very interesting to do, instead of just only psychotropics. So now, how can you help your family member or someone with anxiety? By breaking that neural pathway, start doing something completely different. Repeating, creating a new automatic and subconscious behavior. It's not easy. I'm not saying that this is easy, because it's not easy. Because you are going to see tomorrow, if you want tomorrow, John, when you wake up in the morning, do something different to what you usually do. So it might help you understand how someone is having difficulties to change an unwanted behavior, because that person is behaving like that every single day. So something as simple as changing how you take a shower, it might take you a big effort. Because usually, if I think about myself, you take off your clothes, you go into...
So what do you think, when it comes to shower, you're closed?
I mean, that you don't think about how you do it, and you do the same. So try to do something different, just to break that pattern, even if it's not a big deal, but just to know how you can feel by trying to change an habituated pattern. That's what I was saying here, waking up, showers in the morning. When we work with our clients, I'm aware that some people here are hypnotherapists, they are already practicing with clients, and I'm aware that some other people might want to use the techniques on themselves. And that's okay too. But what is important when we are working with clients is ask for their collaboration. We don't have a magic wand. Sometimes you might be lucky and get an anxiety eliminated in just one session. But usually it's not always like that. Actually, with someone who has been suffering anxiety and depression for 5 years, 10 years, or 15 years, to tell them that they are going to eliminate that anxiety in just one session, they are not going to believe you. And it's going to be difficult to do it. I'm not saying that it's impossible to do it, but usually it might take between 4-6 sessions to create a program for our clients, start teaching them practical techniques to see how they are reacting, using these techniques into the hypnosis session. So I think that we can start now using these techniques, breaking that pattern in the brain, those starting to build new neural pathways. That's what we want to do. We have the neurons here, because in a moment you can start thinking. I'm going to ask you to think about an uneasy feeling, a feeling that you would like to change. In a moment, you can start thinking. We are going to play with that feeling many times. So you can start thinking about that moment. Because I'm going to show you how this first technique works. This is called bilateral stimulation. Am I talking too fast? No, is it okay? Does everyone understand what I'm saying? Is it okay, my accent? All right. So usually people with anxiety, or the anxiety is located in one area of our brain. I don't know if it's the right hemisphere or the left hemisphere. Doesn't really matter where it is located. But what we need to do is to get some balance in our brain. And the way to do this, as soon, in a moment, always, when we are talking to someone, especially clients, okay, the people who are not training hypnosis or hypnotherapy, you can take these techniques, but I'm going to refer to them how I do it in my clinic, in the hypnosis clinic. Because always we are going to ask our clients, usually they are not in an anxiety state when they are in the clinic, we are going to ask them to bring that feeling, that negative feeling. Sometimes they have to heal, they have to feel first in order to heal. So when they have been that feeling, the anxious feeling or the uneasy feeling, we need to give them a rate between 0 and 10. We have to ask the person, okay, between 0 and 10, how is that feeling? Being 10, I'm nearly having a panic attack, and being 0, I'm as relaxed as I can be, more or less, that will be. So it's always important to get this level between 0 and 10, because when you start repeating over and over these techniques, you are going to see how the person, real or imaginary, is going to tell you, okay, now I feel 6. I think that there is a reduction. I think that I'm neutralizing those feelings, and that's positive, because the way that the person can see themselves, that they are decreasing their negative feelings, is by a number. Psychology is abstract. We can't really measure exactly as maths. So this is a way that more or less we can measure how the person is feeling. So with this first technique, I'm going to ask you now, if you want, we're going to do with anything that you might have in your hands, we need to get a balance in our brain, because as I say, the anxiety is just located in one of the hemispheres of the brain. So we need to get that balance. We need to cross something over the center of our body. Something, whatever. But before doing it, it's important to bring that an uneasy feeling, an uncomfortable feeling, if you can, and rate it. You can rate it yourself. Anything that you have, some people might do it. Okay, so just think about an uneasy feeling.
Think about an uneasy feeling.
Something that you would like to change, to improve, an uneasy feeling. And when you have that feeling, when you just start noticing in your body for whatever reason, you can give it a score between 0 and 10. Being 10, the worst, being 0, the best. Being 0, very good or relaxed, and being 10, very stressful or bad. And you can start moving, passing from one hand to another hand, whatever it is in your hands. It might take 30 seconds, it might take 1 minute. Some people do it with a bottle of water, some people do it with a pen, with whatever they have. And you that might be dangerous. And you might start noticing that those feelings, you are neutralizing the feelings. You might start noticing that those feelings are starting to be different. You are neutralizing by doing this. Okay, stop for a second. Okay, so now you rate again. How do I feel now compared to before, to 1 minute ago? Do I feel the same? If I feel the same, again, we do it, we repeat it. If you have decreased a little bit and you notice that the feelings are a little bit lower, you keep doing it. 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. You are getting a balance in your brain. Whoop, whoop. by doing that. Sorry. I know, it's fast, isn't it? Okay, so that's the first one. We're going to go quick with this. After we can practice these techniques, but you know, summarizing, getting into the feeling, as soon as the person, if you are helping someone else, as soon as the person might start noticing an uneasy feeling, hurt, hands, nervousness, whatever, just help them to break the pattern. You are breaking the pattern. That's what we are doing, getting a balance in the brain and breaking the pattern. By doing that. Next one, peripheral, it's called peripheral vision, peripheral, something like that, more or less. Sorry? Well, peripheral vision. So how does it work, this technique? Again, always first thing, an easy feeling, rated. And now, just look at me, everyone looking at me. Focus all your attention on me. All your attention on me. While keeping your eyes focusing on me, just observe the whiteboard. Keeping the attention on me. Expand your peripheral vision, keeping your attention on me. Observe, some people might observe, notice the codes. Just notice how far your peripheral vision is going. Even though you are looking at me, become aware about the people around you, about how far without moving your head, just keep focusing on me. Expand that vision. You can notice, can you notice that even though you are looking at me, you see what's going on in another part of that peripheral vision? Okay. Fantastic. So now, when can we use this? By doing this, we are helping the person just to distract the person again. We are distracting the brain of the person by doing this. And again, you are reducing, you are breaking the pattern, the anxiety feeling. You can use this with someone who has a fear of elevators, lifts. So when the person is just into the lift, starting to focus on the peripheral vision. Usually, the person might get very anxious, looking at everywhere, but looking at nowhere at the same time. So the idea is just, okay, keep focusing on just one thing and amplifying that peripheral vision. Noticing that there are windows, that there is a door, I can see the code, I can notice the code. I can see this person moving and taking off the coat, so I'm amplifying all my peripheral vision. Okay, is that okay? Second one.
Do you ask them what they see?
Sorry?
Is that part of the therapy to ask the client what they see?
Yeah. they tell me what they can see.
Awesome.
As I did now, they are telling me.
So are you saying you're doing this in the clinical situation, or you're telling them to do it in their anxiety situation, and they're really experiencing it?
Yes, I do. I
you're
teach them.
To do it. Yeah. The real use is to do it when they're next feeling anxious, rather than with you.
Well, usually, in many cases, it's not easy that the person start feeling as anxious as she's feeling outside of the clinic. But when they are feeling anxious, even if it's a little bit, if a 6 or a 7, I just tell them to do this or to do the other thing.
Do you think that even just visualizing the problem and doing it here eases it out there later?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You do it, you can get into practice, just keep
once
practicing.
Once you
can conjure up the feeling for yourself. Yeah, because don't forget that all this requires practice. So this is not a magic bullet, this requires practice. It took you 20 years just to get into that behavior. Now it's not going to take you 20 years to break that pattern, but it might take you a while. It might take you 4-6 weeks every day, 3 times a day, 4 times a day, 8 weeks, but probably it's worthy to do it. Anchors. This is an NLP technique. Probably you have heard about neurolinguistic programming. How we can set anchors. Okay, something very simple to do. If you want now for 1 minute, think about something really pleasant. You can, if you want with your eyes open or your eyes closed, feel as much peaceful as you can. Very relaxed, very calm. With your eyes open or your eyes closed, whatever you want. You can start noticing that your legs become relaxed. You can start noticing that that relaxation is moving upwards from your toes towards your knees, your legs, your thighs. You can even imagine that that relaxation is moving into your tummy, your chest, relaxing you, and notice how your breathing has slowed down. Even your heartbeat might feel like slowing down too. And notice that relaxation, even deeper and deeper. You can even now fly with your mind and imagine a beautiful, relaxing, safe, and peaceful place. And notice that feeling of relaxation into your body. Even though you hear the sound of people speaking outside, you can just focus the attention on relaxation, tranquility, and calm. Where in your body do you notice that relaxation? Just notice that feeling. And now you can even increase that tranquility, that feeling, increasing that feeling of relaxation, tranquility, and calm. Now, while holding that relaxation, just open your eyes and look at me. Hold your wrist like this. Hold your wrist while holding your relaxation. Hold your wrist like this. Holding that relaxation. Hold your wrist like this. Feeling calm, tranquil, and relaxed. Noticing your breathing has slowed down. Very good, fantastic. Okay, you can release the anchor. What are we doing here? We are creating a relaxation anchor in our left wrist. So if you repeat this anchor, probably we'll have to strengthen this anchor. Imagining relaxation, noticing the relaxation in your body, imagining a peaceful place. You can guide a family member into this state of relaxation. And when you notice that you are relaxed, just hold that wrist. And anytime and every time that in the future you might have an uneasy feeling, just hold your wrist. And you are going to neutralize those feelings, the uneasy feelings. Anytime and every time that you might feel uncomfortable, a little bit stressed, just hold your wrist, because automatically you might start noticing that you feel calm, that you feel more relaxed, that maybe you can start yawning, and you might even feel more relaxed as you do this. Okay, does it make sense to you?